So hello again. I hope you're enjoying the day. And welcome to our panel discussion, Where Are We Going? So here we will ponder a unique intersection where the once far-fetched narratives of science fiction intersect with the realities of our present. And it's really a testament to human ingenuity and imagination that ideas once confined to the pages of novels and the screens of cinemas are now part of our everyday lives. So what are the next chapters in this ongoing saga of technological advancement? And what are the implications for our society? What does the future hold? What are the next superpowers the researchers will transform from science fiction to science and then reality? To initiate this discussion, Joy Ma, an MIT class of 2024 student majoring in physics and computer science with a minor in theater arts, will read a segment from the Metropolis. This is a science fiction story that was transformed into the first science fiction movie nearly 100 years ago. And following Joy's reading, we will have a conversation with three esteemed panelists, each a distinguished member of the MIT community. We have Professor Josh Tannenbaum, who is renowned for his pioneering work in cognitive science and artificial intelligence. We have Professor Dina Katabi, a celebrated professor in the field of computer networks, whose health monitoring research provides a very unique lens through which we can envision the future of health. And we have Professor Max Tegmark, who is a prominent physicist known for his contributions to cosmology, the future of technology, and AI ethics. And so together we will explore the trajectories of technology, society, and our collective future. And to get us started, please join me in welcoming Joy Ma.
This is Metropolis. Suddenly, he felt, from the back, a certain coldness approaching him. Involuntarily, he held his breath. A hand grasped along by his head, a graceful skeleton hand. Transparent skin was stretched over the slender joints, which gleamed beneath it like dull silver. Fingers, snow white and fleshless, closed over the plan which lay on the table and, lifting it up, took it away with it. Jo Frederson swung around. He stared at the being which stood before him with eyes which grew glassy. The being was, indubitably, a woman. In the soft garment which it wore stood a body, like the body of a young birch tree swaying on feet set fast together. But although it was a woman, it was not human. The body seemed as though made of crystal, through which the bones shone silver. Cold streamed from the glazed skin, which did not contain a drop of blood. The being held its beautiful hands pressed against its breast, which was motionless, with a gesture of determination, almost of defiance. But the being had no face. The beautiful curve of the neck bore a lump of carelessly shaped mass. The skull was bald, nose, lips, temples merely traced. Eyes, as though painted on closed lids, stared unseeingly with an expression of calm madness at the man who did not breathe. "Be courteous, my parody," said the far-off voice, which sounded as though the house were talking in its sleep. "Greet Jo Frederson, the master over the great Metropolis." The being bowed slowly to the man. The mad eyes neared him like two darting flames. The mass began to speak. It said in a voice full of horrible tenderness, "Good evening, Jo Frederson." And these words were more alluring than a half-open mouth. "Good, my pearl, good, my crown jewel," said the far-off voice, full of praise and pride. But at the same being, the being lost its balance. It fell, tipping forward towards Jo Frederson. He stretched out his hands to catch it, feeling them in the moment of contact to be burnt by an unbearable coldness, the brutality of which brought up in him a feeling of anger and disgust. He pushed the being away from him and towards Rotvang, who was standing near him as though fallen from the air. Rotvang took the being by the arm. He shook his head. Too violent, he said. Too violent, my beautiful parody. I fear your temperament will get you into much more trouble. What is that? Asked Jo Frederson, leaning his hands against the edge of the tabletop, which he felt behind him. Rotvang turned his face towards him, his glorious eyes glowing as watchfires glow when the wind lashes at them with its cold lash. Who is it? He replied. Futura, parody, whatever you like to call it. Also, delusion. In short, it is a woman. Every man creator makes himself a woman. I do not believe that humbug about the first human being a man. If male god created the world, which is to be hoped, Jo Frederson, then he certainly created woman first, lovingly and reveling in creative sport. You contest it, Jo Frederson. It is faultless. A little cool, I admit, that comes of the material, which is my secret. But she is not yet completely finished. She is not yet discharged from the workshop of her creator. I cannot make up my mind to do it. You understand that? Completion means setting free. I do not want to set her free from me. That is why I have not yet given her face. You must give her that, Jo Frederson, for you were the one to order the new beings. I ordered machine men from you, Rotvang, which I can use at my machines. No woman, no plaything. No plaything, Jo Frederson. No, you and I, we no longer play. Not for any stakes. We did it once and never again. No plaything, Jo Frederson, but a tool. Thank you.